Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents She is the Law by Michael Anderle. Narrated by Chloe Cannon. Chapter 1. The air smelled of smoke and rain. Lamplights reflected yellow in the puddles on the cobbled street. All was quiet. At the corner of the street, a group of tourists stood, gathered around their guide to Atlantica. It wasn't an unusual sight. For years, the outer world had been obsessed with the treasures that Atlantica had to offer. It also wasn't uncommon for the call to come through to HQ. "Shots fired down Cartwright Avenue," Corporal Leonie Black informed Atlantica Officer for Justice, Terra Kris. "Upper East Side." Terra heeded the call, accompanied by her partner, Tommy Vincenzo. 3 years her junior, Tommy exhibited several traits that rubbed her the wrong way. He always smelled of peppermint, for one. Another was the derogatory tone that accompanied every word that left his lips and aimed toward her.
"Nothing to be done,"
Tommy remarked. His almond eyes peered through heavy lids at the apartment across from them. A milky light leaked into the streets, silhouettes dancing behind the glass. Another gunshot fired, and all they could do was twitch. Terra shook her head, her jaw clenching. She scratched the place where the arm of her smart glasses hooked over her ear, her HUD currently inactive. "We can wait. Let's see how this plays out." Tommy squared up to Terra, eyes locking onto hers behind his glasses, a new addition to the AJS forces across the island. He was an inch smaller, which removed some of his bluster. Terra had seen many guys like Tommy in her old precinct, back when she was sitting in the higher ranks of Officer Justice. Men like Tommy were a dime a dozen, and her cold stare met his as the silence spoke between them. Tommy smirked.
"Need me to report back to Black? Give her the full report that you disobeyed a direct order from your superior officer?"
"Superior?" Terra chuckled. "I thought we were partners."
Tommy let out a derisive snort.
"I outrank you, Kris."
"Only on paper,"
Kris spat back. She nodded at the apartment where a third shot had fired. Someone inside screamed.
"You're telling me that we'd do better off to leave the chaos inside and trundle back to the station empty-handed?"
Tommy straightened his spine.
"This is exactly the kind of bullshit that had you kicked down to the realm of the commoners. Anyone would think you were an Atlantican through and through."
He holstered his Glock 99, standard Atlantica Justice System issue, and turned his back on her.
"Come on, get in the goddamn car. Now."
Terra gritted her teeth, eyes lingering on the conflict inside the building. It was true that she was born and bred on this island, a scrap of land that was discovered back in the latter half of the 20th century, floating about 1,000 miles east of New York City and permanently shrouded in a layer of protective fog. Still, even in the year 2027, she couldn't believe that this was what the law had come to. The wealthy flooded Atlantica the moment the treaty was established between nations. The rules were simple, printed in black and white, and abused by mob bosses, drug lords, cartel runners, and billionaires the world over. What happens on private property stays on private property. The AJS carried no jurisdiction in any area that wasn't public. For a justice-loving officer like Terra Kris, this was a real problem. Too many times had she watched offenses carried out from afar, unable to do anything to stop them, while the perpetrators smiled from the sidelines. This resistance had previously landed her in trouble.
"Kris,"
Tommy barked,
"now."
He stood by the car, 50 feet from where she stood. The tourists shuffled away, disappearing around the side of the corner building, a skyscraper so high that Terra couldn't see the rooftop through the fog. Rain chilled the skin on her face as she shook her head and reluctantly made her way toward the black sedan. What's the point in responding if all you can do is watch from the outside? Terra drew level with the window. She tapped a metal touchpad by her ear. The street lit up in a string of neons and digital script as she looked inside the apartment, the experimental artificial intelligence program attempting to decode what was happening before her. While it couldn't see through curtains or walls, a message on her display did read, 74 Cartwright Avenue, Upper East, Downtown Atlantica, 753-TTY-2. Property owner, Sandy Tomlinson. Age, 37. Criminal background, 2 cases of illegal narcotic vending, 5 DUI offenses, 2 cases of grievous bodily harm, 4 years served in jail. Last convicted offense, November 22nd, 2026. Tommy's voice patched through the radio.
Officer Vincenzo to AJS Command 4, call off dispatch units to Cartwright Avenue. Dispute remains internal and out of our jurisdiction.
Terra deflated. Her eyes lowered to the cobbles, spotting the large puddle before her. She sidestepped, lip curling as the internal shouting grew louder.
Kris,
Tommy called.
Last warning. Ass here. Now.
Terra curled a fist behind her back, then stuck out a middle finger. She smirked, wishing that Tommy could see it, but knowing that it wasn't the best idea to aggravate your partner, especially when under probation. Just ride out the probationary period, Terra. You'll be back up in the big leagues before you know. Voices exploded inside the building. A shrill, female voice cried,
"You dick! You absolute dick! You thought you'd get away with this? You thought I wouldn't see through your bullshit?"
Terra dove to the ground as a series of bullets sprayed the glass. They thunked against its thick layers, forming several spiderweb cracks around the puncture hole. The window shook in its frame.
"You idiot,"
a male voice called. Aged or affected by cigarettes, Terra assumed.
"Are you trying to get us in this shit? You know what happens if the AJS..."
More exclamations rang as shots fired again. 4 more bullets thunked against the glass, the pain shaking dangerously in its moorings. "Come on," Terra silently urged, her eyes fixed on the window. Distantly, she heard the black sedan's engine rumble into life. A window rolled down.
"Terra!
Eat lead, fuckers!"
the female voice crowed. A final spray of bullets rained against the glass. Crimson droplets splattered against the pane. The curtains shredded as the bullets tore through. The glass shuddered. The cracks grew larger. The window disintegrated, bursting forth in an explosion of tiny glass fragments. Terra pushed herself to a crouch, then took a knee. Behind her, the bullets thunked against the brickwork of the opposite building. Terra's face broke out into a satisfied grin. "Houston, we have liftoff." She could now make out the shadows of figures inside from her position down low. She counted 5 of them, frantically running around as they were granted a short reprieve from gunfire. Terra glanced at Tommy. Tommy shook his head, eyes wide, realizing what was about to happen. Terra sprinted toward the apartment, remaining low. She pressed her back to the brickwork and drew her Glock. A man's voice said,
"You fucking moron. Now you've done it. Count the seconds until the AJS comes knocking on your door."
The woman's voice returned,
"Shut your dirty mouth, asshole. How about the next time I invite you over, you fucking pay for the good ink? Instead of giving us this shit heap, you cheap-ass second-class dealer. If I wanted blood poisoning, I'd stain my arms with biro."
"It's top grade, we swear,"
another woman retorted.
"Archimedes only deals in the best."
A warning shot hit the ceiling. Terra drew her weapon and spoke softly into her HUD. "Officer Kris to AJS Command 4, amendment to my partner's previous call out. The situation has progressed. Gunfire has entered the streets. About to perform a BE and AA on the scum. Terra popped out the pistol's magazine and checked her rounds. Satisfied that they were plentiful, she reseated it and thumbed off the safety. A reply came over the radio, the response firing straight along the arms of her HUD and buzzing quietly into her ears.
AJS Command 4 to Officer Kris, can you confirm your terminology?
B-E and A-A, Terra repeated, steeling herself. Break, enter, and attitude adjustments. She muted her radio responses, eyes darting to Tommy, who drew up beside her.
I'll take it from here, he mouthed. My command.
Terra scoffed.
I'm not buying your bullshit, the woman continued. Tell Archimedes that if he wants another sale from us, he best bring his A-game. Not this piss water. I've finished with you bitches. Get the fuck out of here.
Tommy held up three fingers and started counting. Before he could get to two, Terra stood to her full height, pistol aimed through the broken window.
Too late, fuckers. Hands where I can see them. This is official AJS business now.
Chapter 2. For a moment, all was still. Terra had the chance to count the five thugs inside the filthy kitchen, a warm stink of marijuana, sour milk, and body odor hit her nostrils as she used her peripheral vision to scan the room and search out all possible entrances and exits. The woman who had been making all the fuss froze, with her AR-32 pointed at the floor. The shock of Terra standing there, her body shimmering in her metallic blue one-piece uniform, was enough to buy Terra a few seconds to assess. She was older than she sounded. The woman was at least 50 years old, her head sunken into her body with little sign of a neck. She wore a stained tank top, which revealed long, thin arms decorated in red sores. Her veins stuck out from her pale skin, dark gray, instead of their typical blue. Inkheads, Terra thought. Their reports had been going crazy for the latest in the narcotic sensation. Most of her meetings for the last few years had revolved around cases of ink being shipped, sold, and abused in the dark hollows of Atlantica. There was big money in prime product, although from the state of this woman's apartment, you wouldn't think she knew it.
Drop your weapons, Terra warned,
eyes flicking between the group.
Down on your knees, hands behind your head.
Tommy grumbled something beside her, then appeared in the window, pistol pointing at the thugs. The woman smirked. She looked between the two officers, a pregnant tension hanging in the air.
You shouldn't have come.
You shouldn't have invited us. Terra firmly fixed her stare. Bad move breaking that window. Now you've moved into outlaw country, and the sheriffs are here to take you in. Someone moved in another room, footsteps on carpet.
Drop your weapons,
Tommy repeated firmly.
Don't make us shoot.
Of course.
The woman nodded at a man standing near one of the doors. A goatee decorated his chin above a black turtleneck. He crouched slowly, then placed his pistol on the floor. Tommy pointed his Glock at the other three gathered near the corners of the counter.
You two, now.
The three exchanged a glance, then slowly worked their way into a crouch. Terra's eyes bore into the woman's.
Are you deaf? Or just stupid?
The woman's grin remained. Her hand twitched, the mouth of the rifle looking as though it was about to lift and point at Terra. Instead, it dropped lower to the floor.
There we go,
Terra soothed. The woman crouched, the mouth of the rifle touching the dusty tiles. Something knocked in another room. Terra glanced at Tommy. He paid no attention. The rest of the group had their hands behind their heads. On the table was a black briefcase with foam padding, a series of vials, syringes, and something in a metallic case.
Read them their rights,
Tommy instructed. Terra straightened, emboldened at their cooperation.
You have the right to remain silent. Now!
The woman shouted. The word exploded like thunder in the room. A man crashed through a door at the back of the kitchen, rifle in one hand, bullets spraying in all directions as the silence broke. Terra ducked below the window. Tommy spun, his back against the side. All hell broke loose. The woman laughed manically, reminding Terra of the witches she had seen on children's TV shows. Her shots added to the din. Someone yelled in pain as droplets of blood flew through the window. Tommy's face soured. He shook his head with a disapproving glare at Terra. Terra's face hardened, staring at the building opposite as she listened to the noise within, trying to glean the best route forward. She spotted herself in the reflection of a nearby window and noted for the first time that she could now see the thugs inside the apartment.
Bitch didn't let me finish, Terra muttered,
the smile returning to her lips as she tracked the thugs in the makeshift mirror. A moment later, a bullet found the glass and shattered the reflection. Terra had only seconds to make her shot count. She rose from her crouch, high enough for only the top of her head to be seen. She fired her Glock, her bullets sailing expertly through the kitchen and embedding itself in the thigh of the man who had burst into the room. There was half a moment of breathing room, in which Terra pivoted her aim and shot at the woman. The bullet screamed toward her. Bloody fireworks exploded from her shoulder as her body was knocked off kilter. Terra returned to her crouch. Tommy leaned in, pistol pointing toward the group of three. Before he could fire, he drew back. A string of bullets cracked the plaster of the window frame, dust and brick exploding in all directions. Fuck, he grunted, the word coming clearly to Terra through the HUD. Terra chuckled.
Can't stand the heat, Vincenzo?
Tommy glared at her.
This is a warm-up in the inner city, Terra continued. I order an arrest like this with my Starbucks in the morning. Goes down well with an almond croissant.
Tommy frowned. He shot blindly through the window, aiming at the ceiling. Shouts of alarm sounded in the bullet's wake.
Wait until Black hears about this.
I'm sure she's already plugged into our HUDs. Not that she'll be watching live.
Get out of here, you sons of bitches!
The woman exclaimed. Terra shrugged.
That's our cue. Now, where was I?
She peeked over the lip of the windowsill, careful not to cut her hand on the fragments of jagged glass remaining like broken teeth. The woman writhed on the floor. The large thug was unconscious beside her, a pool of blood gathering beneath his leg. Turtleneck and the other three were nowhere to be seen, though a door stood ajar to the side. Terra stood to her full height.
You have the right to remain silent. Anything you say can and will be used against you in a court of law. You have the right to speak to an attorney and to have an attorney present during any questioning. If you cannot afford a lawyer, one will be provided for you at government expense.
The woman reached for the rifle. Her hands were bloody, and the gun slipped from her grasp. Terra brushed aside the remaining teeth of glass with the side of her firearm, then vaulted through the window. Her ass slid across a countertop. Her feet touched the floor. The woman yelled for backup. Terra placed her hand under the kitchen table and flipped it onto its side before crouching behind it and using it as a makeshift shield. The woman cried out again.
Now, you assholes! Get her! Get her!
Terra peeked out from behind the table as a face appeared in the gap in the door. She shot, the shadowed man collapsing instantly to the floor.
Get out of there, now!
Tommy growled. The words came through her ear canal via her HUD as clearly as if he was standing beside her.
Kris, I'm not fucking around anymore.
Neither am I, Terra retorted. Get on board or go home. Justice can be my partner tonight.
She thumbed the HUD, and the information faded. The visuals powered down. Terra could hear Tommy talking outside, but his words remained there, unable to contact her through the glasses. She peeked around the doorway again. The woman had the rifle in one slick hand. Her clenched jaw and bared teeth added to her manic look. Terra ducked out of the open as bullets crashed into the table's surface. Wood splintered in all directions. The noise was deafening. Terra clapped her hands to her ears, accidentally triggering the HUD.
For fuck's sake, Terra!
Tommy continued his tirade of profanity, unbroken from the deadline. Sorry, buddy, Terra thought as she tapped the button again. I'm afraid I'm working above your pay grade. A large section of the table broke away. Terra shrank behind its protection, feeling the vibrations of the bullets against the hard surface. When it seemed that she was running out of options, the rifle jammed.
Damn it,
the woman complained. She whacked the gun against the floor.
Tyson!
Terra peeked out from cover. Another face appeared in the doorway. This time, Terra aimed at his feet, the shot catching the man's toes. Terra broke cover and ran over to the woman. She kicked the rifle out of her weak grasp, sending it sailing across the room. It clattered against the wall. She twisted away, ducking behind the refrigerator as more activity caught her attention, coming from the room with the open door. A hurried frenzy of voices reached her. Come on, come on, come on. Terra looked around the fridge, able to see into the room. The three dealers stood by a large sash window and were fighting with the catch to get the damn thing open. They shoulder barged each other, frantically looking over their shoulder in case she stormed in. Terra placed a finger to her ear. This is Sylvester to Tweety Bird. Get your ass in here and cover my six. Tommy started calling something back, but Terra switched off the HUD once more. She stalked out from the fridge, then dashed to the opposing wall. She pressed her back to the plaster, her body inches from the open door. The sash window slid open. Terra broke cover, appearing in the doorway, gun aimed at the three. One of the men was half out, straddling the frame. He gave a brief yell of surprise before throwing himself out and onto the hard ground. The others turned to follow suit. Terra leaped over a large double bed, the covers yellowing with streaks of black. She fired a warning shot at the wall, which caused the other two to freeze in place.
Freeze! Hands where I can see them!
The woman obeyed and raised her hands. The man, however, turned with an enraged look. His lip curled as he advanced on Terra, his hands balled into fists. Terra smirked.
I knew you'd see it my way.
Someone landed in the kitchen. Tommy's voice addressed the woman. The man swung at Terra. Terra holstered her pistol and swept an arm in front of herself, her forearm blocking the punch and deflecting it out of the way. The man's shoulder lurched left. Terra delivered a hook to his ribs. The man switched momentum and brought his fist back, almost catching Terra in the chin. She leaned back, grabbing his wrist on the swing. With a firm twist, he doubled over. She raised her elbow and struck the back of his neck. The man grunted and fell, face first, to the floor. Someone appeared beside her and shoved Terra off balance. The woman had broken her cooperation and slammed into her side. The pair crossed the room, not stopping until the wall hit Terra's back. She expelled a mouthful of air, then fended off a rapid flurry of blows from the woman. The woman was fast, but with adrenaline and likely some other substances running through her, the blows were weak. Terra hooked a foot behind the woman's ankle and shoved. The woman fell backward, the bed catching her and softening her fall. Terra wasted no time advancing on her, one hand reaching behind to draw out a pair of handcuffs. She slapped one ring on the woman's wrist. The suspect flailed, kicking and wriggling on the bed. Terra's jaw clenched from the effort as she straddled the woman, grabbed the other wrist, and secured the cuffs.
Funny. In another time and place,
this would be considered sexy,
Terra mused. With the final click of the handcuffs, the woman deflated. She stopped fighting, instead choosing to lay on the bed. Terra climbed off her, eyes locked in case she moved again. We good? The woman spat in her direction. Terra shook her head disapprovingly. You want to be careful, ma'am. Jail in Atlantica isn't as safe as it is in the rest of the world. A lot of bad types in there, particularly for... She tapped her hood. Immediately, Tommy's voice filled her head, but Terra ignored it. Instead, she focused on the information appearing on the screen of glass. Particularly for a woman who was wanted for 3 counts of assault, one of solicitation of a political figure. Marcus Rubin? Interesting. And breaking and entering into a public documentation office. Huh.
What?
The woman growled. Nothing on here about drugs. Terra tapped the information away. Must be a new line of work for you. I'd recommend going into something more morally upstanding. The woman grumbled, but chose not to reply. Terra crossed to the window, stepping over the unconscious man, and clicked the latch back into place. She crouched and cuffed his hands behind his back, before standing and giving a satisfied nod. Much better. She crossed to the door, casting a furtive glance over her shoulder. Be a good girl for a moment, won't you?
Fuck you,
the woman shot back. Terra chuckled.
No thanks.
A pistol cocked. Terra sighed. She faced the hallway, unsurprised, to find a man standing a foot back from the doorway opposite. Inside, the room was dark. Light from the doorway revealed only part of his silhouette, but Terra had accounted for the one man missing from their number. The turtleneck was a dead giveaway. The man sneered, eyes flashing as they caught the light when he shifted. Not 20 feet away, Tommy was putting the woman in handcuffs as she protested on the floor. Turtleneck raised a finger to his lips, teeth shockingly white in his mouth. Tara's shoulders softened. The man signaled that she should lift her hands. Terra didn't move. The man's smile faded. Terra's grew. Her hand whipped to her pistol. The man pulled the trigger. Terra ducked. Behind her, sheetrock cracked. Terra fired. The man buckled over, looking shocked as he wheezed his exhale. He dropped his pistol and fell to his knees. Tommy's ears pricked up. He ran toward them, then stopped, to take in the scene of Terra crouched with her gun out in front of her, and yet another dying man in the apartment. A moment of quiet passed between them. Tommy's nostrils flared. Terra raised her eyebrows. Did I do something wrong? Chapter 3. Terra crossed her legs, her ass going numb from the cool, hard steel of the cheaply built chair beneath her. AJS officers strolled along the corridors, eyes fixed to their tablet displays, occasionally almost bumping into each other as they each hurried to their next assignment. Across the hallway, large glass dividers separated the bullpen from the private offices of the senior officers. The bullpen. Terra felt a pulse of irritation well within her as she scanned the dozens of open desks with their standard computer systems on top. Screen displays showed photos of family and friends, and even a few pets. There were ficuses and cacti and mugs that read "World's Best Dad" on the messy desks. The bullpen was a term that she hadn't heard in the inner city HQs, but the precincts she used to look down upon from high used it. She hated it. It was bad enough that the term pig still followed officers of the law into Atlantica, but to adopt the term and embrace it, implying that the officers were considered bullish and in as much need of restraint as the prisoners, where was the respect? Where was the authority, pride, command?
She'll be with you in a moment.
Gina Williams stood in the nearby doorway. She'd pulled her hair back into a tight bun, and glasses perched on the end of her nose. She was young, with bright red lips that drew the attention of the male officers. It was either that or her pencil skirts that stopped just above the knee. She flashed a bright smile, then ducked back inside the office. Terra sighed. She didn't see the problem. She had brought in 4 criminals, quelled what could have been an explosive gunfight, and helped the AJS glean information on Archimedes. Sure, 2 perps had lost their lives in the process, but it had been them or Terra. And that was a battle Terra was never going to take lightly.
Corporal Black, we'll see you now.
Gina offered a warm smile, then held the door open for Terra. Terra entered the reception area. A small walnut desk sat in the corner, the smell of vanilla and perfume lingering in the air. There were metallic filing cabinets, security cameras fitted to the corners of the room, and a door with frosted glass and large golden lettering reading, Corporal Leonie Black. Unconventional. But what does Atlantica care about convention? Terra glanced at a clock on the wall. It was wood, carved into the shape of an owl. The pendulum swung back and forth, the rhythmic ticking enough to make Terra sleepy and a little dizzy. Gina moved in front of Terra and knocked on the door. A voice called, "Come in!" Gina opened the door for Terra. Terra stepped inside. Corporal Black's office was double the size, yet also twice as empty. The only light source was the yellow bulb inside the desk lamp, and the temperature dropped several notches upon entry. A ribbon of smoke ascended from a glass ashtray on the corner of a metallic desk. "Take a seat," Corporal Black motioned to yet another metal chair across from her desk, then folded her arms. Terra obliged, wishing that she was back in the inner city, where the chairs were cushioned and did something beneficial for lumbar support.
"Thank you,"
Terra offered. Corporal Black was quiet and kept her eyes fixed on the wall across from her. She was tall, at least 6 feet at a guess when standing. Her shimmering blue uniform complemented her dark skin. Hexagonal patterns ran across the body piece in large sections. Each hexagon was the very latest in Kevlar protection, nanoparticles that hardened under sudden stress and protected the officer from the worst of gunshot attacks. They weren't foolproof. Each could only withstand a handful of shots before the technology disintegrated, but they were the latest and greatest in personal protection. Terra was surprised that the AJS budget in the outer districts stretched that far, but Lord, was she thankful. Corporal Black's emerald eyes narrowed. Her arms remained folded. There were 2 golden stripes on her left breast. Her left cheek was sunken slightly, the puckered ridge of a scar running almost the whole way from her ear to her lip. She drew a long breath and shook her head. "We have a problem." Terra followed her gaze to the wall. Projected onto the entirety of the large square was first-person camera footage of a place that Terra recognized. She heard snippets of her voice. She saw flashes of her hands as she raised the gun and vaulted into the kitchen. In the background, Tommy was mumbling and muttering as Terra plowed forward with her mission. They watched the full feed together in silence. Terra relived the experience, feeling the adrenaline, the excitement, the fear once more. Corporal Black paused the footage as Terra and Tommy stood outside the sedan. The senior officer was pissed off, and rain fell hard from the sky. In the background were flashes of AJS lights from their backup. Corporal Black let the silence hang. She uncrossed her legs and arms and leaned forward onto the desk.
"You have a problem with authority."
Terra met her gaze, silent in the absence of a question. Corporal Black's stare was intense, but there was something else behind it. Forgiveness. That Terra didn't often see in the faces of her former bosses.
"Do you have any words to defend yourself?"
Black asked.
"Defend myself from what?"
Terra asked.
"Disobedience,"
Black replied.
The situation escalated, Terra returned. Tommy was out of the...
Officer Vincenzo, Black interjected.
Terra closed her eyes to regain her composure. Officer Vincenzo was out of the line of fire. You saw the video. The window shattered, bullets entered public space. I needed to react, to respond, quickly. We trained to de-escalate situations to protect the public. Protect and serve. That's our creed, right?
Black's nostrils flared, though it was brief. Her expression remained calm. I don't need reminding of our creed and morals, Officer Kris. In case you had forgotten, you're addressing a senior officer of the law. I know what I saw, and what I saw was a direct disregard for commands from another senior officer.
Tommy is not a senior officer.
Officer Vincenzo, Black corrected.
Officer Vincenzo,
Terra shot back, temperature rising. He is not a senior officer. He is your superior, Black reminded. You are on probation, Officer Kris. In case you had forgotten, it's because of situations like this that you're in my ranks and on a probationary period where you will be watched, monitored, and babysat by my officers until you're in a position in which we once again deem you fit to serve the Atlantica justice system with full credibility.
Terra stood sharply. I brought you a link closer to Archimedes. I handled a situation that Vincenzo, with all of his infinite superiority, was reluctant to get a grasp on. I applied the training and code of the Atlantica justice system to bring criminals to justice. If that's not what we're here for, then I don't know what we're doing anymore.
Her chest rose and fell with each breath. Her gaze bored into Corporal Black's, who appeared unfazed. She gazed back with the lazy curiosity of a woman watching the elephants stroll at the city zoo. Terra could understand why they assigned her to Black's unit. Most of the other officers would have let their egos get in the way, their heat matching that of Terra's, until the whole situation descended in a flurry of fire and fury. At least, that's what she remembered from Garcia's office. Her former captain might have had the illusion of being a nice guy, a desk smattered in photos of his wife and two children, each one depicting a perfect suburban family. But she still saw the hatred in his eyes, the glee on his grin. None of that reflected in Black. The door opened. Gina poked her head inside, glancing between the pair.
Everything okay?
Black gave a warm smile and nodded. Just venting some emotion, she explained. We all need it from time to time. Thank you, Gina. Gina closed the door, leaving them both in quiet. Sit down, Black instructed, gentle but firm. Terra slowly lowered herself back to her seat. Black sat back in her chair and laced her arms behind her head. There was a harsh light from the computer monitor that caught the contours of her face. You're passionate. I can see that. I don't blame you for being pissed off at the position in which you find yourself. A fall from grace is never easy to take. Terra ground her teeth, knowing better than to say what she wanted to say. That it shouldn't have been a fall from grace. It should have been an ascendance to greatness. She and her partner had uncovered the holy grail of internal corruption. They had followed the white rabbit down Alice's rabbit hole and exposed the whole sting. The only thing they couldn't do was prove it. Tell me, Black offered, narrowing her eyes on Terra, what are your retirement plans? Terra froze, a cold wash running through her. Retirement plans? I'm 28 years old. I haven't even thought about retirement. Black held her gaze. No, Terra's face hardened. You can't make me. This is everything to me, Corporal. I live to serve.
Calm down, Black placated with a lazy wave.
I'm not here to force you into early retirement, though I do need you to think. Your behavior among your colleagues has been noted from the inner city and now here. You're lucky to have been cast down into my little pond. Another precinct would have had you out on your ass so quickly that the scrapes on the asphalt would set you on fire.
She studied Terra for a moment. Thank you, Terra offered weakly.
Don't thank me with words. Thank me with action. I said that you're lucky to have me. Not that I can save you forever. You're a great officer, Kris. Anyone can see that. If you could only learn to get along and work with your partners here, it would make my job a hell of a lot easier. I might be able to see my family when I'm home instead of drowning under 1,000 pages of paperwork.
Terra glanced down at the table. Silence stretched between them. Black sighed. She opened her top drawer and removed a pristine cardboard box. That in itself caught Terra's attention. Nothing in this shit heap precinct was ever brand new. Everything was a hand-me-down from the top wolves. She slid it toward Terra.
I think I have a solution for your problems.
Terra raised an eyebrow. She stared at the package.
What is it?
Corporal Black didn't reply. Terra reached for the box. It was lighter than it looked. She pulled open the tab and slid out a white box with an image of a pair of smart glasses on the front. April? Terra read, examining the large, bold letters on the front.
Brand new. Sent from HQ.
Black continued as Terra took the glasses from the box and rotated them in her hands. They were sleek, midnight black, with tinted lenses. A faint, pulsing blue light in the intersection where the arms met the lenses made Terra think of the AJS cruisers and their flashing cherries.
Experimental, and the first of their kind. The latest in emergency service AI.
Terra snorted. She composed herself when she saw the tired expression on Black's face.
Forgive me, but what are HQ doing sending you guys the latest and greatest in Atlantican technology? Last I checked, you guys were still using printers the company stopped manufacturing in 2001.
For the first time, Black smiled in amusement.
Remember, Kris, you're one of us now. There is no you guys. You're as much a part of this precinct as Maria's ficus is. That coffee stain on the kitchen cupboards in the shape of Italy? That's you now. Get your head down from the clouds and accept where you are. And you can do amazing things here. Who knows? With a little encouragement, maybe you'll finally end up back with your old pal in the inner city. But for now,
she nodded at the glasses.
What am I supposed to do with these?
Terra asked. Black grinned.
Put them on.
Terra turned them over once more in her hand, before placing them on her face. The bridge was a little rough in design, and it was irritating her nose. She reached for the button she had seen on the side of the arm and tapped it. The lenses exploded with light, a message scrawling into the space between her and Corporal Black. Advanced Police Relationship Intelligence Liaison, powered by Tynamo Incorporated. Terra nodded, impressed by the clarity and the smoothness of the display. The words danced in front of her. Some of them faded until all that remained were the letters APRIL.
Pretty sweet graphics,
was all that Terra managed before a voice spoke in her ear. Hello, Officer Terra Kris. How are you today? Terra looked to her side, almost certain that someone was standing beside her. She turned over her shoulder but only found the frozen image from the projector cast onto the wall.
Hello?
Yes, hello. It's a typical greeting that most humans provide each other upon their first interaction with one another. It offers a pleasantry and increases the likelihood of positive interaction. If I didn't know any better, I'd say that you were perhaps the artificial one. Should we check your programming
There was a smirk in that voice, sarcasm leaking off the final sentence. Terra raised her eyebrows, turning to find Black with an earpiece in and grinning. Quirky, isn't she? Terra let out a soft chuckle. AI has certainly come a long way. New officer detected. Scanning now. The office turned semi-transparent as a series of neon blue grid lights scanned and mapped the environment. Terra could see enough of it to identify features, threats, or movements, but her primary focus became a high-definition image of Corporal Leonie Black. She went from sitting to standing, floating in the air. The projection turned the corporal in a 360 view as statistics appeared around her. Corporal Leonie Christina Black, age 39, height 5 feet 7 inches, weight 134 pounds, married to Dwight Harvey Black, children none, occupation senior Atlantica officer for justice, time served on the force 6,205 days, criminal record clean. The list went on, detailing a bird's-eye view of Black's house, her registered vehicles, her medical history, all of it scrolling before Terra in a blur of words and lights. The speed of the information was rapid, and Terra grew breathless while trying to keep up with it all. When the words "last location" appeared, Terra followed as the lenses zoomed in on the real world, passing through a series of interconnected camera feeds, slowly working toward the precinct. Terra saw streets, stores, restaurants, and pubs, until finally, the station came into view. The camera zoomed in, hopping between feeds, until eventually the unit in the corner of Black's office started to blink. Terra looked at the image of Black and herself in the office from behind. From here, she could see the corporal's computer monitor, a replica of what she saw on display. "Pretty sophisticated technology, isn't it?" Black asked. Terra nodded, a little lightheaded as small lights blossomed in the corner of her vision. She tried to reply, but her throat was dry. The attack of lights was dying, but still, the residual images remained. Terra raised her hand to the glasses to take them off. She managed to only get them a centimeter from her face when a blinding pain surged through her head. Terra toppled off her chair, grunting in agony. Her hands rose to her head. The hard floor met the back of her skull. She blinked away the worst of the pain, but her head began to thump. What the hell? She opened her eyes to find Corporal Black standing over her. The glasses are designed only to be removed by a superior officer when you are off duty. They are fitted with a command sequence that can only be accessed by your ranking officer, meaning that when you clock in at the station, you place April on your face. When you finish your shift, I enable you to remove her. Terra grunted, accepting the hand that Black offered her. She wobbled slightly on her feet. Why? What's all this for? Black half shrugged. Since I've run out of prospective officers who are willing to pair with you on a day-to-day basis, this is what it's come down to, Kris.
What do you mean?
Terra knew the answer. Officer Kris, meet your new partner. Chapter 4. Terra popped two aspirin from the metallic sleeve and watched the bubbles form inside the cool glass of water. She stirred the drink with her finger, encouraging the pills to dissolve faster. The headache wasn't too bad, but the dull pain irritated her. Terra was always at her best. She slept the recommended amount of hours, ate the recommended diet according to the latest offerings of the food wheel, and drank the recommended daily dose of fluids. By all accounts, she considered herself a model human. A headache wouldn't do anything to help that. She brought the glass to her lips. A sharp yap made her flinch. The glass slipped an inch in her grasp, some of the water almost spilling on the floor. Terra cocked an eyebrow at the fluffy, white creature standing by her feet. Scooch's tail wagged enthusiastically, a long flag of fluff and fur. Her large, bat-like ears pointed at Terra, and it looked as though she was smiling. The AJS officer hadn't ever seen herself with a toy dog. She had always wanted something big and sturdy, a Mastiff or a Doberman. Still, with the demands of her job and the limited time she had to exercise a larger dog regularly, she had settled for the little Papillon. She had been a gift from an ex-lover. Now 4 years old, the Papillon had become one of the highlights of her day. Scooch hadn't complained when Terra moved to the outer city. She had merely licked the officer's face and curled up to her in the evening for cuddles. That was all Terra needed, and Scooch was happy to provide.
"You scared the shit out of me,"
Terra softly stated as she set the glass of water down. She picked Scooch up and cradled her in her arm.
"You need to be careful of alerting Mommy. You know I'm a trained killer. I'm licensed and armed at all times."
She smiled at Scooch as the dog strained her neck to lick Terra's nose. Terra brought her closer and closed her eyes as wet kisses warmed her face.
"How's your day been?"
She placed Scooch down on the floor, then downed her drink. Scooch ran excitedly in circles around her.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.